I am aware that I have a short time, and therefore I try to be as brief as possible. To the program, I insist that it is not enough to introduce a new treatment in any kind of medical fields. We always have to expect and to consider expectations and drawbacks of this new treatment on the system level for other treatments and on the public health and public order level. So this is why I choose this title and this presentation. And this is what I'm going to talk about. Opiate maintenance is not a new invention. It has a very long tradition going back to the antiquity. Second, I want to very shortly say what is heroin-assisted treatment nowadays at present and where is it practiced. Then I go to the main concerns against this new treatment approach, look at the effects on the treatment system level, and look at the effects on the public health and public order levels. Finally, a word on the economic aspects and major conclusions. Opiate maintenance has been practiced with smokable opium since antiquity. In non-medical rationing schemes, opiate tincture in maintenance clinics nowadays in Iran. So opium still is prescribed as an agonist for opiate dependence. Morphine, medical prescription of injectable and oral morphine started in the 19th century. And finally, medical prescription of injectable diamorphine is an innovation of the 20th century. These two references give you most of the information in a very detailed manner. Where is heroin-assisted treatment practiced nowadays? Since 91 in Switzerland, 95 in the Netherlands, 2002 in Germany, 3 in Spain, 5 in Canada, and in the UK, or in England, only in England, not in the United Kingdom as a whole, in Denmark since 2009, and Belgium had RTC in 2011, but is not continuing at the present. In all others, except Spain and Canada, where it can be prescribed only on a compassionate basis, heroin-assisted treatment is nowadays part of the regular treatment system and paid by health insurance. What is it? What are the main characteristics? This is very important to know in order to understand the outcomes. The framework, it's a comprehensive assessment and care program and needs-based individual treatment regime. It is not an overall general regime, and it is not just handing out prescriptions for heroin ampoules to heroin-dependent people, as it was practiced for decades in the UK. The target population, and this is most important, has only in mind people with failed previous other treatments. It's not for all heroin addicts. And there is a minimal age and social and or health deficits, serious deficits, have to be documented to be able to enter this kind of treatment. And also, most importantly, it's about supervised intake of injectables. It's not handing out prescriptions, with a very restricted take-home regime for oral preparations. Injectable heroin in these programs cannot be taken home. And this has two major advances. You can go to the necessary dosages without concern of producing an overdose. And secondly, you are not risking that this prescribed heroin is going to the illicit market. Now, what were and still are in many countries the main concerns against this new treatment? One myth is there will be limitless hunger and the demand for ever-increasing dosages. The other one is patients will be hooked to heroin forever, and their will for recovery will be very weak. On the system level, we have to fear an increase of heroin-related mortality and morbidity, a deviation of prescribed heroin to the illegal market, lower threshold for starting heroin use, handing out the wrong message to young people, if it is only a medication which can be used in medical programs, it cannot be so bad. Negative impact on other treatment approaches and misplaced resources, which could be used for better purposes. Now, about the demand for ever-increasing dosages. You can see here the average individual medium dosages over 18 months staying in treatment. There is a slow increase in the beginning because at the start you're very cautious with dosages in order to prevent overdose. But afterwards you can see a slow reduction in medium daily dosages, contradicting completely this myth for a demand for increasing dosages. About weakening the will for recovery, this is the Kaplan-Meier curve about how long are people staying in heroin-assisted treatment. And you can see that about 50% are leaving the program within 3 years of participation. And after 6 years, it's going down to almost nothing. Also, this is very instructive, but the next question is, what will happen to people when they leave? When they leave the program, will they just go back to illicit heroin? No. This shows you the referrals for drug-free treatment from heroin-assisted treatment in Switzerland as related to duration of treatment. And you can see that the numbers are, especially during the first year of staying in treatment, of patients who are referred to drug-free treatment are important. If you look at the overall picture in all the countries where heroin-assisted treatment is practiced and compare the selected outcomes over time across the scientific study, mostly randomized controlled studies, and looking at significant improvements only, you see the following. Health improvements over 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, 18 months, 24 months, And even 4 years, 4 years documented in the Netherlands. Reduction in illicit heroin use, documented even over 6 years for those who are still in treatment and for those who had left treatment and are follow-up. This study in Switzerland. Increased employment rates and reduction in crime, especially reduction in crime, has been shown in all these countries. Now, what is the impact on the treatment system level? Let me show first the total capacity of this treatment in comparison to other agonist maintenance treatments for heroin dependence. I try to make it short. We have a total of 58 specialized clinics in these countries with a total capacity of around 3,100 slots. While the numbers of patients in opiate maintenance treatment, substitution treatment, overall in these countries, is over 360,000. Showing that the percentage in heroin-assisted treatment of all these opiate-substituted patients is less than 1%. The place of heroin-assisted treatment in the EU treatment system a few years ago is shown very clearly. About 70% of substitution treatments use methadone as a medication. About 25% buprenorphine, and less than 5% retarded morphine or heroin. So it's a very small fraction of all heroin-dependent people who are included in this type of treatment. The evolution over time, you can see in this slide. In Switzerland, the rates of methadone assisted treatment, the yellow, is mostly constant. From 1993, when heroin-assisted treatment started, to 2008. And the rates for heroin-assisted treatment and for drug-free residential treatment stayed about the same over time. But this is not the only thing which is of interest. We had looked at the impact on other treatment approaches. And these are some of the key issues. Other treatment approaches, especially the methadone maintenance treatments, had a less burden of the most chronic and problematic heroin-dependent clients or patients. People who continue to inject illegal heroin or who switched out and in into other treatments without positive effects. These are mainly covered by heroin-assisted treatment now. Second thing, setting new quality standards, because you can imagine that the quest for good quality treatment in the heroin-assisted treatment was politically and professionally very high. And this had an impact on other treatment approaches. So setting new quality standards for comprehensive and personalized care has been one of these side effects. And finally, I want to mention that all these randomized controlled studies showed improvements also in the control groups, where patients received the same treatment as before, where they failed. And this is a strong indicator for needed improvements in the routine treatments. But as I mentioned, we cannot look only at the treatment system. We have to look at other systems as well. For instance, is it the wrong message for young people that heroin cannot be so bad? Look at how the rates of first heroin use in Switzerland went down during the period when we introduced heroin-assisted treatment to the levels almost of 1975. Newcomers to the heroin scene, which was exceedingly high in the early 90s and late 80s, went down tremendously. And this is on the basis of information from our monitoring system. Mortality went down by about 50%, and new HIV cases due to injecting drugs went down considerably. Of course, this is not only due to heroin-assisted treatment, but it has assisted quite essentially to this development. Reduced delinquency of patients in the program. On the left-hand side, you see the data for 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, and 24 months. All these reductions in delinquency of people who went to heroin-assisted treatment in comparison to delinquency they showed before entering are highly significant. But also, in general, the police notifications for drug use regarding heroin users went down considerably at the price of a slow increase in cocaine users. Now, economic aspects. Heroin-assisted treatment is not cheap. One of the main factors is that you need the presence of staff for long hours, because injections had to be made under visual observation and with the assistance in case of any kind of negative effects. So we had a good look at the costs of this treatment in our country, and not during the research period, but when it became routine treatment. You can see the effective costs per patient day and the all over costs of 28 million Swiss francs per year for these selected patients. The amount and cost of diamorphine we used, and there is not yet accounted for the contributions from the Federal Office of Public Health regarding the monitor, the data bank, the handbook, coordination, education, so on. We also made a cost-benefit analysis showing that the benefits, mainly due to a reduction of delinquency and improvement of health in these patients, is about the double of the costs. In other countries, we see about the same. The system how to estimate and document these numbers has been different, but the overall finding is consistent. There are more benefits from participating in this program than costs. This is a strange picture because what you see, the green columns are based on data from the Institute of Medicine in the US, and the orange one is the estimated costs in dollars at that time for the Swiss treatment system. And I show this one only because it demonstrates so visibly that prison costs and untreated addiction costs are at least the double of the cost for heroin-assisted treatment. So the main conclusions. The implementation is feasible and safe. All randomized controlled studies show superior results in comparison to controls. The concerns about this treatment are in striking contrast with positive outcomes for participant patients as well as on the system level. Although small in numbers, it is contributing remarkably to reduce heroin-related problems for public health and public order. And the higher costs are compensated by higher overall deficits. Thank you very much.
Est-ce qu'il y a des questions dans la salle avant qu'on passe à la présentation suivante? Miguel, oui.
Oui, moi je crois que j'avais une question, parce qu'elle est partie. Quand vous dites que les personnes, quelle est la durée moyenne exactement d'un traitement parce que vous dites qu'au bout de 7 ans, il ne reste plus que... combien? Très peu, oui. Au bout de 7 ans, il reste très peu de patients.
Oui. La moyenne, c'est un peu 3 ans.
3 ans, la moyenne. Mais oui. C'est-à-dire qu'après après ces 3 ans, ou après les 7 ans, on va dire, pour l'ensemble de la cohorte, là, les gens qui sont partis du traitement, ils sont allés vers autre chose, on les a perdus de vue. Le fait qu'ils ne soient plus dans le traitement médicalisé, d'héroïne médicalisée, veut-il dire qu'ils en ont... fini avec leur addiction, ou est-ce qu'ils sont allés retourner, enfin,
c'est très important.
Oui.
En effet, la majorité de ceux qui sont sortis du programme sont retournés à la méthadone.
Retournés à la méthadone, d'accord.
Oui.
Mais pourquoi?
Parce que pendant la période ils ont reçu ce programme d'héroïne, ils ont été en état de normaliser leur quotidien.
D'accord.
D'insérer ou bien dans un travail ou dans une éducation additionnelle ou quoi que ce soit.
Réinsérer socialement.
D'accord. Et ça, c'est une très bonne condition pour mieux profiter des programmes de la méthadone.
Oui. Les gens ne veulent pas y rester dans le programme au-delà, disons, de 7 ans. Pas rester dans la...
Parce qu'il n'y a plus de liberté dans la méthadone.
Oui, tout à fait. Oui, parce que là, il faut aller au centre toutes les 2 fois par jour.
Alors, on a la liberté de réduire les injections d'héroïne à une injection par jour, le matin ou le soir, et le reste de la journée est couvert par les effets de méthadone oral.
D'accord, ok.
On fait la combinaison. Mais Chaque jour, il faut se présenter.
Oui, et puis et même souvent deux fois par jour, puisque certains peuvent avoir
deux, trois, quatre fois.
Fois par jour, oui. Voilà.
Ok, c'est clair. Merci.
Philippe Michaud, Paris. Quel est le contenu de l'accompagnement psychologique, au sens large, psychothérapeutique, qui est offert dans les centres suisses d'injection assistée?
Les centres suisses, le contenu psychologique.
What is the psychological content of the?
Oui. Quel est son contenu?
Of the treatment. What is the job of people being there? They don't do only watching on the safety of the injection, so they do also some things on the psychological level. What is the content of this, please?
Allow me to answer in English now.
Yeah, sure.
Of course, I mentioned that the program is at the very individual level, and it's not a one shoe for everybody. So everybody who needs psychotherapy, obviously, and is ready to accept psychotherapy, can receive it. Or an individual psychotherapy, or be included in some kind of group psychotherapy, group therapy, or in family therapy. In many cases, partner therapy or family therapy is indicated because the relations to the family are broken during the her independence period. So this is open, and if it is indicated, it is paid by health insurance. And of course it can continue after leaving the program, because this is one of the main factors for enduring stabilization, that these things are not interrupted. There is a continuity of contact with psychotherapists or social workers or whoever.
And is
Could
the staff?
I answer your?
Yeah, sure. Is the staff trained with motivational interviewing or behavioral therapies too? Motivational interviewing. Are the staff in the centers trained? But.
What kind of therapy? Oh, well, you know, our country has a very strong tradition in psychoanalytic and other psychotherapies, which are more or less in this field. But behavioral therapies, of course, are also indicated and have an increasing importance. And family therapy also has a long tradition and has a high standard.
Une question, oui.
Nguyen from Vietnam. So I have two questions about the heroin-assisted treatment. First, do you have some reason for comparison between heroin-assisted treatment with methadone and buprenorphine? Secondly, for heroin-assisted treatment, how do you monitor the use of illegal heroin? With methadone and buprenorphine, we can use urine tests yes. to detect morphine. But with heroin-assisted treatment, so I imagine that you must base on the patient's telling.
Because they use this
Thank you. Yes, I got it. This was an important question, especially in the UK, where you have two parallel systems. One is the old system of handing out prescriptions, and people can inject or sell it or do whatever they like. And the new system, which is, let me say, the Swiss model, with a highly controlled intake and no deviation. So it was, for the Brits, it was very important to find how you can differentiate, and they found a way. It seems to be quite easy. I can't give you the details, the pharmacological details, but if you send me a mail, I can give you the respective references.
So the heroin given in the institution is different from the illicit
street heroin?
Heroin?
Oui. They can differentiate the street heroin and your heroin in the left.
Our heroin is pure. It is not coming from police confiscations. It's original heroin with proven purity, where the street heroin many times has additional ingredients.
So maybe I didn't express my word. So the question is how do you monitor the use of illegal heroin?
A majority of persons took heroin from the street.
They can differentiate street heroin from
street heroin and institutional or medical heroin.
Okay. Yes, you can. You can in urine analysis. You can differentiate.